Hey guys, so I again gonna share this every time, but got some decay, got placed a little low, decided to take a weekend, get myself back to Masters, and I even got closer to Grandmasters than I expected, but overall it's been a lot of fun. It's been a really cool journey. It took me about a weekend to get from about Diamond 4-ish all the way up to Masters, and I did it, I would say 50-50 on solo queue, and I would sometimes duo queue with one other person. So in this case, I was queuing with Camille, who is a Grandmaster player, and we also have Lynn, who's a Grandmaster player on our team that we queued with. Or sorry, we queued into, we didn't queue with. Against us, we've got Kyle K and Biohazard, both Grandmaster players. So this is a Grandmaster game, guys, but it could still be a little janky, who knows. So I'll talk a little bit about the playstyle of Deckard Cain, and then I'll get into the build as we get there. But I do need to start off by saying I do pick Sapphire, and that's going to be very important about the playstyle. When you're playing Deckard Cain, the big thing is to try to land roots and slows to the best of your ability. But there are a lot of times where you have to throw out... if you want to land your root, you have to throw out Sapphire to slow people enough to where your root's going to land. Or you can use your root simply for zoning. And you'll see that I use mine for zoning here or there, where we'll be having a fight near their towers, and I'll just put a root at their towers. And they decide, they're like, wait, we can't go into our towers or else we'll get rooted. So they walk back into the fight and then they die. We started off in a pretty good spot. If you're noticing, I do leave healing potions in different lanes as we're going through fights. And it's just a tool that I use a lot of times so that in case my team needs healing on different lanes, they can get healing. Which is why I actually really like Deckard for maps where you may have two people leaving in a, or sitting in a lane for a while. In that case, I use Sapphire to slow them down enough to where the root would land. And again, just throwing out potions to the best of my ability. I'm trying to take damage from the Sylvanas for as much as I can, because if I take damage, it's easy for me to stay alive because I have that extra 10 armor, and my team doesn't need to worry about picking up potions or anything because I can just drop the potions on myself as often as I want to. One of the big things about Deckard is you really don't need to worry about divers at all. You have a decent amount of survivability, especially since they buffed his health recently. You don't ever really need to worry. Again, if you guys see, I use Sapphire to slow her enough to where she can't get out of the root, and then she got hit by the root. So I Sapphire into Roderick's Cube into Ceiling or Scroll of Ceiling, if you're good with it, guarantees a root. And it's the only thing that's actually going to guarantee a root in this game. Now there's a couple other like weird things you can do. So I do go kind of a strange build this game, and my reasoning for it is because I wanted to test. This was all about actually just testing his changes. I wanted to see how tanky he was. Again, Sapphire slows him, root gets him, and then after that, he actually got hit by the Leap of Faith, so he was able to get out. I did want to grab that camp, but right here, again, Sapphire. And I threw it kind of far out because I thought they both wouldn't have died. And they ended up dying. So that's kind of the cool part. Is Deckard is one of the best heroes if your team is coordinated, your team is high rank. He has one of the best engages out of the supports. Pre-10 engages, I think he does have the best engage out of all the supports before level 10. If you're good at it. But you also need to make sure you're not just throwing it randomly. Look at my mana. I'm blowing through mana right now. So you can't just throw it out randomly. You need to make sure that it's a target that your team can actually follow up on. If you've noticed, all of my roots are targets that my team is already attacking or my team's prepared to attack. I'm not ever throwing roots on things that my team's not attacking. Right here, I just throw out one potion. I was going to throw out one more and then start channeling. Deckard's another great hero for channeling. Like I said on Lucio, where you have to channel a lot of the time, he's a really great hero for that because you can put out all of your healing before the fight starts and then just channel. And it's like your team still has a healer. Right here, I decided I was going to soak for him, auto attack a couple times just to speed it up. I mean, little Cain auto attacks are not really worth very much. We do see the Sylvanas is coming in. We can scare her off. Sapphire, she actually dodges this. Again, Kyle K, he's been a Grandmaster every season. He knows what he's doing. I head back up here to grab this point, and this is where it kind of gets sour. Really, Greymane should have just finished off the point, but it's whatever. Every team gets three throws in Masters. It's just what it is. So Cube Mastery got a buff. Its cooldown, it's actually gotten a couple buffs the last couple patches. So now it reduces the cooldown by even more and reduces the mana cost by even more. So I've been wanting to mess around with this talent a little bit. And just so you guys know, essentially what Cube Mastery does is when you hit heroes with a Herodric Cube, it's going to reduce the mana cost. It reduces the mana cost flat whether or not you hit heroes with it. But if you hit heroes with it, it shaves off 4 seconds per hero hit. It's got a 16-second cooldown, which means that if you hit four heroes, you get its cooldown completely back. And that gives you a pretty decent window. Even if you hit two heroes, just shaving off half the cooldown's not bad. You're going to see that come in handy a little bit later. Do I still think it's better than Emerald? Probably not. And I'm going to give you guys that right now and just say, yes, it looks like it gets a lot of value this game, but I still don't think it's as good as Emerald. That's why, like, when I tell people that Emerald is really good, I'm not kidding. It's an amazing talent if you get good at it. But if you're not great with managing all of the gems, I would say try out Cube Mastery. It wasn't bad, and it was actually kind of funny. It did save me one time this game, to the point that it was pretty hilarious how much it actually saved me. But we do have a bit of a fight happening up here, but we have the objective spawning down there. This is a map that you can give up objectives whenever you want to, and I have a feeling we are going to give up objectives. I didn't get a sapphire there, so I didn't end up getting the root off. I mean, I didn't have Sapphire off cooldown, so. Kane does have struggles with keeping everyone topped off, so just keep that in mind as you're playing him. He is one of the, I would say, weaker healers right now, but he's a utility healer. Kind of like Rhaegar post-16, where those roots can get a ton of value. I mean, his are not technically roots. Rhaegar's aren't technically roots, but it's the same thing. Like, Deckard gives you those roots. He gives you the chance of getting some major value. But yeah, I think he's a really cool hero. He gets a lot of value, but I do think that he normally requires a little bit more coordination. So let's talk about the other talents that I picked up. I thought that whether he went Taunt or Colossal Smash, I like Potion of Shielding, because if they're going to charge into someone after Colossal Smash lands, you know they're going to take a lot of burst damage, so giving them a shield is really nice. This is the talent against burst. This is the talent against poke. Put simply, I never take Ruby. There may be situations where it's very good, I just never take Ruby. As far as the rest of the talents here, I like Sapphire. Sapphire is, again, that's your engage. It's amazing. Cube Mastery, we'll see a couple areas where it does get some values. In fact, this is one of the areas, if I remember correctly, where it does get some value. But not a huge fan of... I love Emerald so much. It's such a good talent. So right here, we get flanked, and this is all five of them down here. And normally I feel pretty safe around a fort, but I completely forgot that they had Sylvanas. So all of what we're doing right now is a mistake, and we should get punished for it so hard. But we actually have kind of an interesting fight here. We just play it out. I sleep a couple people, I root a couple people, and then I give myself a potion, another potion. And they're all clustered together. So what do? I throw out my root, and then I throw out my W and then my root. But because it takes my W a couple seconds before it goes off, my root is still able to get the cooldown reduction. So then I fire a second root off in a different direction so that I can root everyone else again. And it does end up giving our Joanna time to get pretty far away, but she's still gonna end up dying. However, it gives me time to get away from the enemies while the enemies are dealing with the structures. Our team's gonna clear up this structure while getting the top camp. Even though that worked out for us, it does not mean it was not a mistake for us to be there. It was a mistake for us to be there. We could have been with our team and just destroyed top for free and not had the Joanna die from that. So just keep that in mind, that results-oriented thinking is not always a good thing. Just because you don't get punished for something doesn't mean that it was something good that you should have done. So they used a lot of their ults here, and we still have a decent amount. I mean, we'll have the majority of our ults back. We'll have Blessed Shield, we'll have that. We'll just be missing March. And we're doing a lot of damage. I'm pretty much just hanging out. And right here, they end up sitting all way too close. I get an amazing root. So you see myself use Stay While after my roots a lot while my team's attacking. And this is something that I feel is very, very underrated. One, because there's actually a 0.5 second window where people can take damage after being slept before they get woken up. So there's a 0.5 stun everyone. And that's where my team got a lot of value off. You can see Greymane already got one auto attack on a slept target. The next reason why I like doing this is because it catches everyone in the fight your team isn't attacking. And now you have this fight where essentially half their team stunned and half their team is fighting back. And the third reason is purely because it could interrupt random things. It also tends to grab people that might be trying to flank your team because it's got such a wide radius that I love throwing down a root and then immediately sleeping. And sometimes if you get it timed fast enough, this is after 2.25 seconds and this is after 1 second. So if you plan it out right, you could also do it in the reverse where you throw out your root and then you sleep everyone so they get hit by your root. And it turns that 0.5 second sleep into a 1.5 second root, including that 0.5 second thing. So 2 seconds. They're essentially locked down for 2 seconds. So combining your ult with your abilities is a great way to drop people out. You can see Anduin sleeping for this entire fight until he gets woken up and I get another root off and then we hit those. Like, there's nothing that the enemies can do in this fight. They are getting dropped in every single area because I'm just CC, 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 CC. And it's like root, sleep, slow, root, sleep, slow. It's like just there's just nothing that they can do. And that's why it's such a powerful tactic for doing that. Because we have so many auto attackers and people that are everyone on our team is using some form of auto attack, I believe I end up going Ancient Blessings, especially since this Sylvanas is just backdooring the entire game. And Ancient Blessings is a great way for you to get siege area back. But what I actually recommend for people that are trying to rank up in this game is Super Healing Potion. This thing is very, very underrated. Especially in the competitive scene. Everyone thinks you have to go Ancient Blessings in the competitive scene. You don't. Super Healing Potion can heal for 1,000. It is insane. But when you just are spending a lot of your time instantly winning team fights, and also you'll need that extra siege damage, is why I go Ancient Blessings. It's still not bad in team fights like this, where you're not really sure how everything's going to play out, so you pop Ancient Blessings so that your team at least gets some extra damage, and they get some extra healing as well. But we will end up losing this. We won't lose that. Interesting. Okay. This is actually a pretty awkward fight. I might just ult here. And again, this is what I was talking about. You can ult. So I ulted, which slept them, and they took damage right after the ult, and they still stayed sleeping. I sleep this. So the only person that stays awake here is the one that we wake up, and we can turn the fight around if we wanted to. I will be continuing to throw more roots and 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 slows and roots and slows. You know, it's like, it's such a cool ability right here with Cube Mastery. But again, it's like Emerald's super good. So I'd say in coordinated teams, get Emerald. In uncoordinated teams, so this is what you're going to change around, right? Uncoordinated teams, you're going to take Cube Mastery and you're going to take Super Healing Potion. In coordinated teams, you're going to take Emerald and you're going to take Ancient Blessings. And I think that's really where I would adjust those talents. And start using Deckard like that. I think if you like Deckard's playstyle, try it out. It's pretty fun. And it can get a lot of value. It's pretty entertaining. And look at that. Those potions. I mean, that shield potion's not bad. And then I pop Ancient Blessings, and we get a nice kill off of that Ancient Blessings. And now I'm coming down here, throw a potion, and start channeling. Pretty easy. We could probably grab bot first before I channel, but I didn't want to risk it. I would rather get the channels that I know we can get. We can always grab other stuff back later. We've got Leoric. He's going to clear this lane up and try to do what he can to the Sylvanas, but it's pretty rough. We're going to take back bottom and continue that on. I don't have a lot of mana, and this is a big issue about this build. I mean, this talent has definitely improved it, but it is still a big issue about this build. Level 16 is a huge power spike for Deckard, as long as you take anything except for safety and numbers. If the enemies have divers that are going to be constantly diving on you, Herodric's staff is amazing. It's also great for people like Chen, where it's an instant interrupt. So if he dives in on you and then tries to use Storm Earth and Fire, you can instantly interrupt it. And again, Sapphire Root would have gotten rooted if we would have had... if the leap of faith didn't go off. There's a sleep. Again, that 0.5 seconds is just enough that a lot of times, and again, a root to get the kill. So my favorite level 16 talent, though, is Scroll of the Stone Curse. If you hit two people, you do 3 times your damage. That means at this level, what would be doing essentially 300 damage is going to be doing 900 damage. It's a really cool talent for doing just that surprise damage that no one's expecting on Deckard. Herodric Staff, though, is still a really good talent. I just don't like getting in the enemy team to get value off of it, so that's why I only use it if the enemies are going to be trying to dive me. And as a Deckard, you really don't usually need to worry about divers, but it's nice to have a talent that can not only you don't need to worry about them, but you can also punish them. So if a Genji or something comes in, it's like, oh, boom, dead. So the enemies are actually invading our top right now. We will be probably just sending one person to grab this. In fact, I'll probably grab this and let Greymane go up and help them out. Because Deckard has this problem that his heals require setup, you showing up late to a fight is pretty much like you not showing up at all, unless you're just going to CC everything. But you showing up late means that your team's not getting any healing. So unless you really can land all the CC and that CC is going to change the fight, it's better to not show up at all. And that's why I just decide, you know what, I'm not going to be able to heal anyone. I'm just going to grab this and then I'll still head up there because we still need me to be up there, but I'm not going to like rely on it. And there we go. Sapphire root slows them. I end up missing pretty much everything except for my root there. But it's still enough. We get a lot of value out of it, get a kill, and we'll be able to take this as well. 2 sets of 5 damage. It's a nice 10 damage for a team. Actually, sorry, 15 damage all off of one objective because we were able to grab back bottom. I grabbed this, our team grabbed this, and we also were able to grab that. So again, in Masters, every team will always throw 3 times. You just need to make sure that your team, I don't know why he's going in again. He almost got killed there. But again, sometimes when people are thinking through it, it's pretty deadly. Because if this Jaina saw that Anubarak already used his Q and his E, she could walk in with no health, and she's still safe to do so. So our team's going to try to grab back top while we are going to grab this. Or I guess it wasn't 3 sets of 5 damage because I didn't realize the enemies had this. So it was actually just 12 damage, so 3 sets of 4. Deckard's also pretty good for tanking a lot of camps because you can heal yourself and you get armor. So not bad. They're grabbing back this. It's usually best to just give that to them whenever they're trying to grab stuff like that. I do use my ult here to sleep, and this is what I was talking about sleeping people that you might not be focusing. We were all focusing the Sylvanas, and I stopped them from trying to stop us from killing Sylvanas. Now, she got kind of far away, and the Anubarak did use Unstoppable to get in, so we don't end up getting the heroes we want to get. So I decided to just kind of get our team to get out of the fight. And we did use an ult there. We did use Sapphire there. So we don't have a lot going for us. But they are getting really low. So we could just take the fight and go in. I fire off a root. Don't end up hitting anyone because it was kind of blind. And now I just need to do whatever I can to keep Jaina alive. Again, I don't worry too much about divers. You have a lot of survivability on Deckard. He has a lot of health. In fact, before he got that health buff, I would have just died there. And then I just whack her with my staff, and we have this point. That's going to give us 5 damage, and then boss is also available, so we will be able to channel bot while my team does boss. And again, if I don't show up to set up, but I'm not going to help speed up boss at all, so that's why I'm going to focus on the bottom objective while my team focuses on the boss. Now, just so you guys can see, this is the build that I went with. This talent right here is like the major reason why I go for Stay a While and Listen, is because this is game ending. I already like Stay a While, but this is absolutely game ending. So I love that, and that is essentially how I play Deckard, just to kind of go through my build one last time. Sapphire, I pick every single time. This I pick if they have burst, this if they have sustained damage. Cube mastery is what I would recommend if your team's not coordinated. Emerald if they are. Stay a While and Listen is just my favorite ult. Lorinado is good, don't get me wrong. Ancient blessings if your team's coordinated. Super healing if they're not. Scroll of the Stone Curse if you don't need to worry about divers. Herodric if you do need to worry about divers. And then Respect the Elderly is insanely good. I mean, silence and blind after they wake up means that they cannot fight back. So every time that's a good time for them to fight, you pop that, they cannot fight back, you win the fight, it's game over. And this is how I use Deckard to dominate. The early game is pretty much just abusing the fact that you have one of the best engages in the game, pre-level 10, as a support. Abuse that with your team, you'll get kill after kill after kill. This time, I only actually queued up with one person, and we were still able to get those kills left and right. If you find yourself struggling to get those kills in your rank, then I would say that Deckard's probably not the best for you because he doesn't have wave clear, he doesn't have camp clear, and his healing is not the greatest. As you can see, level 20, 57,000 healing, it's not amazing right now. But it's still there, and you can still get a lot of value off of his utility in games. So if you are playing with friends that can follow up on your stuff, if you're queuing with one or two other people, try out Deckard. He's a really powerful hero. For the rest of this, feel free to throw any comments down below, any extra tips you can give to other people playing Deckard. I have used him multiple seasons to move up in rank, even after he's kind of gotten the pro treatment where he's gotten nerfed down because he's used a lot in the competitive, or at least he was used a lot in the competitive scene. Either way, thank you guys so much for watching, and feel free to check out my other videos.